Simon & Schuster Audio presents As a Woman, What I Learned About Power, Sex, and the Patriarchy After I Transitioned by Paula Stone Williams. Read by the author.
For all who believe living authentically is sacred and holy and for the greater good. What you write this for? This is a poem written for me by my friend Nicole Kelly Vicky at the start of writing this book as a reminder of what I was writing it for. Don't write it for the money or just to feel known. Because this won't feel like that. It will feel more like pouring out your soul to an empty room. Responses will come at odd intervals, and often from the people hit the hardest. I've read so many authors who have brought me to tears, to a fundamental understanding of some corner of myself, and I never ever wrote one a letter to tell them so or say thank you. Be wary of wrapping up storylines that aren't finished yet. Hold space for new chapters in new books. You don't yet know where this will all lead, or how you will fit again into some future iteration of a friendship that once felt like it kept you alive, but right now feels a bit like a dead end. Write it for the souls out there behind you on a similar path, the ones who feel like they were born somehow wrong. Who need the map of what it took for you to set things right. Those who are growing under a broken parent, who learn how to be loved by studying others who've also had to learn that for themselves. Those who find themselves stuck in marriages that have grown to fit all wrong, and yet are still the most comfortable thing they know. Those who feel pressed into careers but have to name them callings. Those who give their whole hearts to causes which consume them and shut the door. Pour out the blood of your story so that one day, down some dusty library row, the right reader will find you, take you home, ink up your margins with notes like, "This is me," read you in their bath, hold you in their hands, as the tears they don't show anyone else blur your pages, though you will never meet. Or know their names, or how your words ineffably change them. Introduction. Trusting the flow. It's never too late to be what you might have been. George Eliot. I had a big dream, but could not hold on to the details except some vague sense that I'd been immersed in water. As I stared at the ceiling, all I could feel was the dream's heft, pregnant and profound. A week or so later, the dream returned, focused on the water in my backyard, water that returns to itself as it falls and swirls over boulders and stones. The water is stuck in a Sisyphean cycle, falling only to be pushed back up, moving swiftly but going nowhere. I have to fill my backyard water feature every 5 or 6 days. Weary of its circular journey, the water gives up and evaporates. The babbling brook is not self-sustaining. It requires electricity to run the pump and a human to fill the basin. The water has to be handled. Rivers do not have to be handled. Rivers should be trusted. I walk down from my house to the nearby St. Vrain River and its unfamiliar pathways, carved by a 2013 storm of biblical proportions. The river, more a stream most seasons, now meanders through fields where Black Angus once grazed. It makes its way into and out of its old riverbed, following the instructions of an ever-evolving Mother Nature. In spite of its new twists and turns, the river still knows where it is going. The river is going to the sea. The river is not stuck. I was. Stuck, that is. I had been going through my own storm of biblical proportions and felt like the water in my backyard water feature, cascading down only to be forced back up. That was the essence of the dream as it returned time and again. About a month after the recurring dream began, I was visiting friends in New England. As the full moon cast its scattered shadow on early spring snow, I sat by the fire with my friend Carol and talked of being caught in a never-ending cycle. She looked at the stuck me and said matter-of-factly, "You're stuck because you're trying to go back. You know you can't go back, right? Seriously, you know you can't go back. You have to let go and trust the flow." I was not trusting my heart. I had spent decades resisting its flow, engineering results more acceptable to my upbringing. But they were Rube Goldberg creations, convoluted machinery that never could really stop the flow. But life provides opportunities for redemption. And eventually, the slow work of God had brought me here, to this place of yielding, where I might trust the flow and its long and winding journey to the sea. Nowadays, people say, "You are so brave and courageous." I'm one of the first transgender people they have ever known, and they want to express their admiration. I am touched, but for a long time I felt neither brave nor courageous. I allowed my charmed life to stop me from trusting my heart. I was a successful white man, the son of an evangelical pastor, the CEO of a national ministry, a magazine editor and pastoral counselor. Because I was one of the leaders who controlled the agenda, I never had to give up a part of myself. When I went into a business meeting, I did not have to worry about how I was dressed, or the accent with which I spoke, or the language I used. Life was tailored to my needs. The world was made for my pleasure. Yet I was restless and depressed. When you stand in opposition to your heart's desire, you're going to feel restless and depressed. Your own soul is judging you. My life was unfolding in opposition to my heart's desire. But life is ultimately generative, and requested or not, the soul does eventually rise up and cry out, "For God's sake, get a backbone." That's what happened by the fire that snowy New England night. Carol's words sent me searching for my backbone. I found it where I had left it, in a fit of fear, and it spoke with a voice I could not deny. I had been called. The feeling in Carol's living room began in my gut and crept into my soul, burning hotter than the fire holding us in its embrace. My legs were crossed, and as my heart raced, my right foot moved ever so slightly with each throbbing beat. I couldn't take my eyes off of my foot, moving, restless, ready. My heart was demanding to be heard. I was being called to move, to leave the comfort of the meaningful life I was living and embrace the more dangerous life churning within. I was called to transition genders. Paul was to give way to Paula. Was the call from God? Who knows? I do know it was from a place so deep it scared me, a place that had never been granted freedom. It came as a knowing of the heart, born of conviction, accompanied by enormous fear. It arrived with demands. It is easier to live unaware, to get out of bed in the morning and leave your better half under the covers, ignoring the life you might have chosen if only you could have mustered the courage to choose it. It is easier to give up the terrifying possibility of freedom in exchange for the relative comfort of community, even if it is a community of people frightened of the wrath of the gods. It was a decade ago that I took in the full measure of Carol's words as we sat around the warm fire. Afterward, I spent a great period of time lost. But it's all right, because lost is a place too. Sometimes you have to spend a season or two there. I offer no excuses. It takes a long time to answer the big questions. There are periods, sometimes years, when you just have to prepare dinner and put the kids to bed and finish the laundry and fix the blinds by the bay window that open crooked before you are finally free to take the road less traveled by. All the giant leaps do not have to come at once. My heart spent decades preparing to receive its call. When it finally came, it took longer still to let go and trust the flow. Eventually, in fits and starts, I exploded the family narrative and shocked a whole denomination and transitioned from Paul to Paula. I lost all of my jobs and a lot of my money and most of my friends and stepped onto the road of trials with barely a clue what to do or where to go. Was I ready for this? No one is ready for the trauma of transitioning genders. No white man is prepared for the loss of privilege. But I had been called, so I listened to my heart and jumped in the water and hoped for the best, trusting that the river does know its way to the sea. This is the story of my trip to the sea. We are all on a journey, maybe our first, maybe our last, but all into the unknown. But this living is serious business, and we are pilgrims, called by our better angels to live authentically. For all the uncertainty, we can know two things. The heart yearns to be free, but it will never be free until you let go of the world to which you no longer belong. Everything after that is a sacred and holy adventure. Part 1, Chapter 1, My Wedding Night. Opening his arms, he said quietly to her, "Disappear here." Jonathan Carroll. A cold, hard rain was falling across the south shore of Long Island. It had been pouring all day, through the Sunday morning church service, the afternoon football game, and again as I drove the few blocks to the church late that evening. It was December 31st, 1972, my wedding day. I was 21. Kathy was 19. Her father had decided it would be marvelous to have our wedding ceremony at 11:30 p.m. and be announced as husband and wife shortly before midnight. And so it was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.